Dear listeners, welcome to the NIOS studio. Today we will be talking about the relationship of sociology with other social sciences. The social sciences that we will be looking at today are history, economics, political science, psychology, and social work. What we need to understand here is that, like all social sciences, sociology, history, economics, psychology, and anthropology are independent subjects. However, they are also interdependent with each other and they all study society in different ways. Let us begin by talking about the relationship of sociology and history. The French historian Fernand Braudel was the first to actually talk about the relationship of sociology and history in a very formal manner, and he had a very interesting take on it. What he said was, he said that the relationship of sociology and history is like a dialogue between the deaf. Now, if you know that when you're talking about it being like the dialogue between the deaf, what actually happens is that one does not listen to the other. Both of them are saying what they have to say and they are not looking at one another. They're not even listening to one another. They are completely ignoring one another. So that was exactly the case between history and sociology. History, as we all know, studies human societies and emphasizes on the differences between them and the changes that have taken place over societies over a period of time. Sociology, on the other hand, at that point of time, meaning I'm talking about the 18th century, you know, sociology was thought of as being a natural science, as you already know from the subject about the emergence of sociology. You know that the original sociology, when it started, had to deal with societies in a manner which was very similar to the way that the natural sciences dealt with their subject matter. So historians were very, very critical of sociology at that point of time, and what the historians thought was, they thought that sociology was not really a very serious subject. They did not realize the fact that sociologists too were studying societies just like they themselves were. Now historians, for their matter, used inscriptions, they used records, they in fact very extensively also used government sources in order to understand societies at that point of time. As opposed to that, sociologists collected data through fieldwork. Sociologists used the historical method as well in order to study society, and extensively what sociologists also did was that they used something called social history. By social history, what it means is that sociologists relied on a lot of artifacts like objects, artifacts like clothes, artifacts like food, artifacts like books, literature, published material, printed material, in order to understand society at that point of time. And gradually what started happening was that in the 1950s and in the 1960s, the two disciplines began to converge. And as you already know, that both Max Weber and Karl Marx extensively used the historical sources to write on society. Max Weber, for instance, looked at the rise of capitalism in Western Europe in a historical way. Similarly, Karl Marx also looked at the rise of capitalism using his dialectical methodology, in which he looked at the history of societies and how is it that capitalism came to prevail in different societies. And today what we find is that historians and sociologists are both taking interest in each other. It is now no longer the dialogue of the deaf. Sociologists study contemporary societies, but they also use historical methods and historical sources in order to understand society. Now, when we look at the relationship of sociology and political science, formally speaking, the two disciplines are very different from one another. Formally speaking, meaning the way that they are taught, the way that they practice their discipline. What we find is that political science, as you all know, is the science of the government or the science of polity. It studies the organs of state. The focus of a political scientist is on complex, advanced, modern societies, rural or urban. If you look at sociology, sociology also studies the political process, but the focus is on social institutions, the focus is on political institutions. And they look at political institutions as one of the various social institutions that exist. And what the sociologists do is, they look at what are the various mechanisms of social control and how is it that political institutions are used to maintain social control. Now, the moment you're talking about social control, what you are basically saying is that you are looking at institutions which help us to regulate behavior, institutions which help us to ensure that interaction amongst individuals is systematic. Now, the study of the political process, therefore, can be something which is carried out in simple as well as in complex societies. So, sociologists can also study the political institutions in societies which are technically classified as stateless societies, meaning they do not have a state in the way that we understand the word state today. For example, you could talk about the Nuers of Southern Sudan, the Ashanti of Ghana. These are all tribes which are also known as stateless societies. So, the focus of a sociologist is on political institutions, is on understanding the various mechanisms of social control like sanctions in order to maintain law and order in society. Now, when we look at the relationship of sociology and economics, again, the difference here is that sociologists look at economic institutions. They look at how is it that different social processes intrude and influence and impact economic processes. Economists, on the other hand, are concerned with aspects of production, distribution, exchange and consumption. Economists study economic systems of complex modern urban industrial societies. Economists focus on the formal economic processes, right? So, economists are concerned with demand and supply, rational use of resources, issues of economic development. Sociologists too are concerned with economic development, but for them, the focus would be on the social factors of the economy. They will look at social factors which will influence the consumption, distribution and exchange of goods. They will look at the micro level processes as well as macro level processes. So, what we will find here is that sociologists, for example, will look at the impact of kinship, religion and social values on the economic processes. Typically, an economist will not look at factors like that. So, for example, if you were a bit earlier in the context of political science, I was relationship with political science, I was talking about the Nuer of Southern Sudan. Similarly, if you were to pick up another tribe, let's say, for example, the Trobriand Islanders, studied by the famous anthropologist Malinowski, what we will find is that as a social anthropologist or as a sociologist, you will look at the mechanisms of gift exchange. Now, gift exchange is again a very vital process of economic institutions in small scale societies. And when you are looking at gift exchange, when you are looking at the consumption, distribution and exchange of resources, you are looking at how is it that the consumption, distribution, exchange and redistribution of resources takes place in the context of social factors like kinship. You will only deal with your kinsman, you will only deal with a particular kin group and not with everybody. So, what we find is that the relationship between sociology and economics is again different. They are different from one another, yet they do tend to converge with one another, right? A sociologist will also be studying economic processes, for example, in a small-scale society like the Trobriand Islanders. The Trobriand Island, as you all know, was studied by Malinowski, the famous British anthropologist. So, a sociologist will also be looking at economic processes. He will also be looking at that what are the various kinds of economic resources and how is it that the use of these economic resources is determined by social factors like kinship, religion, values, norms in a small-scale society. So, that means again what we are saying here is that economics and sociology overlap with one another, yet they differ from one another. Now, if we look at the relationship of sociology and social work, which is the next subject that we are looking at, what we find here again is that a student of sociology generally assumes that they will end up doing social work. It's not a wrong assumption at all. But you see, what happens here is that the training of a sociologist and a social work student are a little different from one another. Because you see, what's going to happen is that sociology is a pure science dealing with theoretical concepts and methods of social research, etc. And social work becomes the applied part of sociology. Now, when I say that social work becomes the applied part of sociology, that does not mean that they do not intersect with one another, does not mean that they do not overlap with one another. They do. But the difference here is that as far as a social worker is concerned, a social worker will also be dependent on carrying out extensive field work and looking at the various conditions that are there in society from the point of view of bettering them, from the point of view of making situations better. And a social worker would also be dependent on sociological insights in order to understand society. So, you see what's happening is that a sociologist need not always be looking at societies from the point of view of bettering them. That may not be the aim. The aim may not be to really go and work with communities. Whereas, as far as a social worker is concerned, a social worker, the end product, the desire is very, very different. So, what you can say here is that sociology is the study of social action and social work is the technology of that social action. Now, when we look at the relationship of sociology and psychology, which is the next subject with which we are examining the relationship of sociology with, again, there is bound to be a little bit of confusion because both of them are studying societies. But a psychologist focuses on an individual. A psychologist uses quantitative as well as qualitative techniques in order to understand social behavior, in order to understand social behavior and human behavior. A sociologist will focus on social facts which govern the way that people behave, which govern the way that people interact with one another. For example, in a courtroom, what you will find here is that a sociologist will focus on laws and the judicial system. The psychologist will focus on the psyche of the criminal, of the judge, of the jury. Now, what you find here is, see, for a psychologist, the focus will be on examining the reasons for an individual's behavior from the point of view of mental processes. A psychologist will focus on understanding the human body, the human nervous system, its impact on the behavior of the individual. And a sociologist will be focusing on the impact of social factors on the behavior of an individual. Let's take an example of suicide. Emile Durkheim, the famous French sociologist, studied suicide as a sociological phenomenon. Now, typically when one talks about suicide, one assumes that there are psychological factors which leads an individual to commit suicide. So, from a psychological perspective, when you are looking at suicide, you will be looking at the mental processes, the psyche of the individual, which compelled the individual to commit suicide. You could also be looking at, for example, the processes like chemical imbalance in an individual's nervous system, the impact of various hormones on an individual, which compel the individual psychologically to commit suicide. From a sociologist's point of view, as Emile Durkheim did, when you look at suicide, A, you're not really looking at the suicide of an individual. You are looking at suicide rates. That means you are looking at suicide as a collective phenomenon. You will be looking at that how is it that the suicide rate in a particular society varies over a period of time. And then again, you will be looking at what are the social factors which have compelled an individual to commit suicide. Is it that the individual is feeling very isolated? Is it that the integration of an individual in society is problematic? Why is it that the soldier has committed suicide? Why is it that the soldier has opted to go on a suicide mission? Maybe there is an over-identification with society. So, you see, from a sociologist's point of view, the focus will be on social solidarity and the impact of social solidarity on the individual's behavior, right? Similarly, when you look at social psychology is again that branch of psychology which is looking at the behavior of an individual in a crowd. Now, here is one branch where you might find an overlap between sociology and psychology. But please, dear listeners, do remember that sociology and psychology are entirely independent of one another as formal disciplines. Now, when you look at sociology and anthropology, during the course of this very discussion, you must have noticed that I am using the term sociology and social anthropology interchangeably. It's not as if I am making a mistake. In fact, I'm doing that purposely. And the reason why I'm doing that purposely is because social anthropology and sociology overlap with one another. But we'll come to the overlap in a little bit. First, let's understand technically, or how is it that conventionally anthropology is understood as opposed to sociology. Now, conventionally, when one is talking about anthropology, one looks at anthropology as the study of biological and cultural aspects of human beings. Anthropology has various branches like physical anthropology, like social anthropology. Now, physical anthropologists, for example, look at the physical artifacts of a particular culture. For instance, a student of physical anthropology will be looking at skulls, bones, maybe utensils, maybe various tools of that particular society, maybe even foodstuffs. And they look at these various things in order to understand that society, right? So that's the physical aspect, therefore physical anthropology. Now, physical anthropology exists along with social anthropology, and it is social anthropology that really interests us as sociologists. Now, social anthropology, that branch of anthropology which is looking at the cultural and the social aspects of society. And the question that then arises is that if social anthropology is looking at the cultural and the social aspects of society, then how is it different from sociology? My dear listeners, the difference between social anthropology and sociology is really a difference which can be traced to the beginnings of the two disciplines. Now, when I talk about the beginnings of the two disciplines, let's take the example of India. Now, when you take the example of India, what you need to understand is that India, when I say let's take the example of India, I mean it from the point of view or from that time period when India became a colony. Now, India was colonized by the Britishers. Not only India, but the Britishers also colonized several other societies which were less developed than their own society. So, what the Britishers found was that these less developed societies were very different from their own. Like earlier, I spoke about the Nuer of Southern Sudan. I also spoke about the Trobriand Islanders. At some point, I mentioned them as well. The Trobriand Islanders studied by Malinowski. Now, both the Nuer and the Trobriand Islanders were studied by the social anthropologists who were British. So, what the Britishers did was, when they studied societies which were less well developed than their own, the study of those societies was labeled as a study by social anthropologists, right? Now, if a social anthropologist is studying societies which are less developed than their own, that means a social anthropologist will look at phenomena like kinship, phenomena like religion, will look at phenomena like, let's say, for example, social control, will look at phenomena like stateless societies, will be also looking at things like economic institutions. Now, how about a sociologist? A British sociologist, as opposed to a British social anthropologist, will be looking at societies which are complex, which are industrialized, and which are urban, meaning that a British sociologist will be looking at societies which were very much like the British society, right? So, they would be looking at phenomena which would be predominant in those societies. So, a sociologist ended up, therefore, looking at urbanization, ended up looking at social stratification, ended up looking at phenomena like family, not kinship, but family, right? Though they are the same, but a social anthropologist will call it, you know, kinship, and sociologist will call it a family, because what you are doing is you are looking at kinship relationships in the context of a modern urban industrial family, right? So, you see, sociology and social anthropology became labeled artificially as being different from one another. Social anthropologists looked at simple societies, and a sociologist looked at more complex societies. And obviously, they began to have different departments. So, a student of social anthropology would be enrolled in the department of anthropology, and they would get a BSc in anthropology, right? Whereas a student doing sociology at the undergraduate level will get a BA in sociology, and they would be enrolled in departments of sociology. But, you know, gradually what started happening is, over a period of time, the difference between sociology and social anthropology has become very, very minimal, and they extensively overlap with one another. So, sociology has a very close relationship with social anthropology. Though, of course, the differences in various countries do remain. For instance, in the United States, what happens is that social anthropology is referred to as cultural anthropology. And if a student of sociology from, let's say, the University of Delhi in India was to travel to the United States to study sociology, they would get enrolled in the departments of anthropology rather than the departments of sociology, right? So what we see here is that sociology and social anthropology tend to overlap with one another. In India also, as you've seen in some of your earlier chapters, when you're looking at the history of development of sociology in India, the first departments of anthropology were established in Calcutta University. And the first departments of sociology were established in Bombay University, and these were started by social anthropologists, W.H.R. Rivers. So what I'm saying here is that traditionally anthropology was considered to be the study of simple and tribal societies. They studied societies which were less advanced than their own. So anthropologists in Western countries like America and Britain studied tribal societies in those parts of the world that they colonized. And they studied them from the point of view of better administering them, from the point of view of better understanding them, right? These societies were very different from their own societies. Hence, departments of social anthropology and departments of sociology were set up very differently from one another, right? So what we see here is, now if we were to look at certain photographs, like for example, if you were to look at the todas of Nilgiris. Now the todas of Nilgiris were studied by social anthropologists and not by sociologists. But if you were to look at your discussion on kinship, we did give you examples of the todas of the Nilgiris, right? Now todas are a tribe. You are studying all that Ivy said that you do study in terms of social relationships, in terms of economic relationships, in terms of political relationships as well, right? So for example, if you were to look at the Nishi tribal from Arunachal Pradesh, that would be again somebody studied by the social anthropologists and not by sociologists. So in order to sum up the relationship between different disciplines, what I would like to say in conclusion is this, that economics, political science, psychology, social work, social anthropology are formally very different from one another. They are all taught in different departments. And the reason why I mentioned that they are taught in different departments is to establish that how very different they are from one another in terms of their formal nature. But practically, when you try to study societies, you will find that there is a very close collaboration between the practitioners of all these disciplines. So for example, if you were to study, let us say, a river in India, if you were to study, let's say, the river Yamuna in Delhi, the river Yamuna in Delhi would be studied by practitioners of all disciplines, right? They would be looking at the river Yamuna, what has happened to its river waters, what has happened to its banks, etc., what has happened to its pollution that we find in the rivers, from the point of view of an economist, from the point of view of a sociologist, and also from the point of view of a social anthropologist. What I would very strongly recommend listeners for you to do is to go back and look at the emergence of sociology and social anthropology, and to go back and study them extensively. Thank you.